Since Hitler had proclaimed himself Fuhrer of Germany in 1933, he had embarked on a steady program of economic, military, and territorial expansion. Within 6 years, Germany had reclaimed nearly all its land and people lost at the end of the First World War 21 years earlier. Europe had done nothing to stop Hitler's aggression. Even when the Reich invaded Czechoslovakia, an independent country that had never been part of Germany. As the world awaited Hitler's next move with bated breath, none were more apprehensive than neighboring Poland. At 4:45 a.m. on September 1st, 1939, the massive and technologically superior German military machine plunged across Poland's border. Although Hitler had disregarded yet another international treaty by attacking Poland, he had still felt the need to justify the Reich's actions legally. As with Germany's recently regained territories, the Polish port of Danzig had once been German, and nearly a million Germans resided there. Hitler wanted them back inside the Reich. Poland was doomed. To the world, Hitler had announced, Danzig was and is a German city. All the German minorities living there have been ill-treated. But in private, he was more direct. Danzig is not the subject of the dispute at all. It is a question of expanding our living space in the East. Hitler did not want to provoke France and Britain into war, and publicly claimed that, in fact, Poland had been about to invade Germany. The Polish state has refused the peaceful settlement of relations. Germans in Poland are persecuted with bloody terror and driven from their homes. A series of violations along the German-Polish border prove that Poland is no longer willing to respect the frontiers of the Reich. Does anyone really believe that the German nation will stand for that from such a ridiculous state? To put an end to this lunacy, I have no other choice than to meet force with force. Long live the Reich. Hitler's instructions to his military were clear. Close your hearts to pity. Act brutally. 80 million people must obtain what is their right. The strongest man is always right. In 18 days of fire and hell, the German military decimated Poland. 50,000 Poles were killed, and 750,000 had been taken prisoner. A gloating Hitler invited foreign correspondents to view the wreckage of Warsaw. Poland's capital. Gesturing toward the devastated city, he said, "A great crime has been committed here. The Polish military went mad, and look at the crime committed against their own people. They were drunk with power and talked of marching on Berlin. Then they barricaded themselves in the city, and look at Warsaw now." Sheer sympathy for women and children caused me to make an offer to those in command of Warsaw, to at least let the civilian inhabitants leave the city. In truth, Hitler had ordered special SS units to follow the army across Poland. It was their job to murder every educated Pole they could find. Doctors, police, the clergy, Jews, landlords, and the nobility were all butchered. When Poland finally surrendered, less than 3% of the Polish upper class remained alive.
This morning, the British ambassador in Berlin handed the German government a final note, stating that unless we heard from them by 11 o'clock, that they were prepared at once to withdraw their troops from Poland, a state of war would exist between us. I have to tell you now that no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently this country is at war with Germany.
Although England and France both declared war on Germany, they still failed to act. Hitler now held all the cards, and he was not about to relinquish the initiative. Privately, Hitler mocked British and French leaders, calling them coffee-drinking old aunties and referring to their diplomats as worms. But publicly, he continued to offer reassurances. "I have declared that the frontier between France and Germany is a final one. I have repeatedly offered friendship and the closest cooperation with Britain. Germany has no interest in the West, and we have no aims there for the future. With this assurance, we are in solemn earnest. As long as others do not violate the neutrality of Holland and Belgium, we will take every care to respect it." As always, Hitler had something very different to say to his inner circle. "My decision is unchangeable. I shall attack France and England at the earliest favorable moment." "The neutrality of Belgium and Holland is of no importance. If France and England strike, let them do so. It is a matter of complete indifference to me. Today is Tuesday. By next Monday, we will be at war with someone." Over the winter of 1939 and 40, German troops made light of the continuing standoff. But Hitler's general staff were laying plans for all-out war. "The basic aim is to lend the operation the character of a peaceful occupation, designed to protect, by force of arms, the neutrality of the northern countries. But the operation should come as a complete surprise. We must deal the enemy a decisive blow right at the start. If Holland and Belgium are successfully occupied and held, and if France is also defeated, the fundamental conditions for a successful war against England will have been secured." While Germany prepared for an offensive in the west, the British boarded a German supply vessel, the Altmark, in a Norwegian fjord. Hitler was furious. The Nazi war machine moved into action on April the 9th, 1940, and struck north. Launched an attempted counter-invasion, but did not persist for long. In a matter of days, Denmark and Norway collapsed under the German onslaught. Just 1 month after the occupation of Denmark and Norway, the German Wehrmacht launched its full-scale offensive into Western Europe. Holland, Belgium, and France were invaded and overrun in only 40 days. British and French troops resisted the onrushing tide of panzer tanks. But the dive bombers and soldiers surging toward the Atlantic coast were relentless. Even Hitler was amazed at the ease of his latest victory. The German armed forces have truly surpassed themselves in this campaign. Nothing is impossible for the German soldier. No power in the world can drive us out of this region against our will.
What General Weygand has called the Battle of France is over. The Battle of Britain is about to begin. Upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization.
Reveling in the collapse of France, Hitler laid aside the question of Great Britain long enough to visit Paris and gloat over his latest triumph. The generations which follow us will no doubt accept without comment the unification of Europe which we are about to accomplish. I cannot stress too strongly that this had not been made possible by the efforts of statesmen, but by the force of arms. But Hitler had already made his first mistake. Nearly 500,000 French and British troops had been trapped on the French coast at Dunkirk, but Hitler had called off the panzers. Had Hitler pressed his advantage, he could have wiped out any effective Allied resistance for years to come, but he let the moment pass. Between May the 28th and June the 4th, the Royal Navy evacuated more than 300,000 experienced combat troops to the safety of England. It was a mistake that would come back to haunt the master of Europe. For the moment, Hitler believed he was invincible. If anybody other than myself had been at the head of the Reich, he would have lost his nerve. No one will ever have the confidence of the German people as I do. There will probably never again be a man with more authority. From the Atlantic coast of France in the west to the Russian border in the east, and from the north coast of Norway to the Mediterranean, Adolf Hitler held Europe in a stranglehold. Europe will be an impregnable fortress, safe from any threat of blockade. After that, everything will be simply a matter of organization. To secure the newly conquered Atlantic coast, Hitler ordered the construction of 1,500 new gun emplacements extending from the northernmost point of Norway to the Spanish frontier. Building would go on for years to come. I am irrevocably determined to make the European front unassailable by any enemy. Nothing could persuade us to abandon such safe posts as those on the Channel coast. You know, we have given Europe a great piece of good fortune, namely peace. Peace that will be protected by German might. And this might can no longer be broken by any world power. That is our pledge. See, Kyle. Among the German military and at home, the Fuhrer's popularity could hardly have been higher. Thousands of streets bore his name, and in 1940 alone, he sold nearly 1 million copies of Mein Kampf. Despite his antagonism toward everyone else, Hitler never quite decided how to deal with the British. Imagining them members of the German race, he seemed to think they would eventually join his genocidal crusade. If the English are clever, they will make an about turn and march on our side. By getting out of the war now, the English could succeed in putting their principal competitor, the United States, out of the game for 30 years. But Britain's tough new Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, was having none of it. He said that if Hitler were to invade hell, I would find occasion to make a favorable reference to the devil.
We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
Hitler was well aware that the island nation presented technical problems to a traditional blitzkrieg-type attack. Britain enjoys one immense natural advantage. She is completely surrounded by a gigantic anti-tank ditch. Hitler made one last appeal for Britain to see reason. I feel it my duty to appeal once more to reason and common sense in Great Britain. I am in a position to make this appeal because I am not the vanquished begging favors, but the victor speaking in the name of reason. I see no reason why this war must go on. Churchill replied with action. In August 1940, Britain's Royal Air Force bombed Germany. Hitler struck back with interest. The trouble has come. I did everything humanly possible, almost to the point of self-abasement, to avoid it. I repeatedly made offers to the British, but it was all in vain. They wanted war, and they made no secret of it. It will not be as easy a war as they think. It will be a war of such destructiveness as no one has imagined. Just weeks after the collapse of France, German planes began an intense bombing campaign against Britain. The Battle of Britain and the London Blitz, which continued for 7 grueling months, took the lives of more than 7,000 civilians. Despite England's tenacious resistance and the loss of more than 300 German warplanes, Hitler remained confident that England would collapse in a matter of weeks. As an island, Britain might have been immune to Hitler's panzers, but its vital supply lines were desperately exposed to the German U-boats. With this in mind, Hitler began planning his next major conquest. Since the beginning of his political career, Hitler had considered communism one of the world's great evils and frequently insisted that any cooperation with Russia is out of the question. But just before invading Poland, Hitler had surprised the world. The government of the Reich is ready to cultivate, with the Soviet Union, friendly relations profitable to both parties. Given the fact that Soviet Russia has no intention of exporting its doctrine to Germany, I no longer see any reason why we should still oppose one another. Russia and Germany wasted no time in dividing up the spoils of Poland between them. My pact was only meant to stall for time. We will crush the Soviet Union. Hitler needed time to marshal his resources and prepare the armed forces before taking on the Russian behemoth. He knew his enemy well enough to realize that if Germany didn't attack Russia, sooner or later, Russia would attack Germany. By late 1940, Hitler somehow convinced himself, before even Britain had capitulated, that Germany could conquer Russia in just 2 months. The German armed forces must be prepared, even before the conclusion of the war against England, to crush Soviet Russia in a rapid campaign. We need only kick in the front door, and the whole rotten edifice of communism will come crashing down. What matters is that Bolshevism be exterminated. Moscow, as the center of the doctrine, must disappear from the earth's surface. No organized Russian state must be allowed to exist. The German invasion of Russia would repeat the blitzkrieg-style attack that had worked so successfully in Eastern and Western Europe, but on a scale far more vast than anything in human history. stripping 80% of Germany's military out of occupied Europe, Hitler assembled an invasion force of more than 3 million men, supported by 3,000 tanks, 6,000 field weapons, and 2,000 aircraft. On June the 22nd, 1941, Operation Barbarossa began. The German Wehrmacht crashed across Russia's 1,200-mile-long western border. In the north, they headed towards Leningrad. In the south, toward the Ukrainian capital of Kiev. And in the center, toward Moscow itself. Russian military were incapable of mounting any real defense. A string of bloody purges by Stalin had left 35,000 of his own officers dead. After only 1 month, Russian prisoners of war marched in columns stretching from horizon to horizon. After 5 months, the captives would number nearly 4 million. The loss of Russian equipment was staggering. Collapse seemed imminent. Hitler openly scorned the poorly equipped and badly led Russian soldiers. "This enemy consists not of soldiers, but of beasts. They fight with truly stupid fanaticism, with the primitive brutality of an animal that sees itself trapped. This must be a war of extermination." Increasingly, Hitler was interfering with his generals' decisions. Stunning victories in the West and now rapid success in the East had boosted his confidence. Certain that Russia was doomed, Hitler paused the drive on Moscow and diverted his panzers to mopping up operations. Before the advance was resumed, 3 weeks of invaluable dry weather were lost. In spite of his general's warnings, Hitler had started a war on two fronts, and winter was fast approaching. By November 1941, the weather began closing in on the German army. Rain bogged down men and equipment, and when the temperature dropped to minus 40 degrees, the advance ground to a halt. Hitler's generals begged permission to retreat to defensible positions for the winter, but Hitler refused. "The troops are to dig in where they are and hold every square yard of ground. I believe I'm entitled to ask any German soldier to lay down his life." With temperatures so low that a man could be permanently crippled by the cold seeping into his flesh through the nails in his boot soles, the Blitzkrieg ground to a halt only 20 miles from Moscow. Unable to accept reality, Hitler accused his own men of cowardice and his generals of being incompetent and traitorous. "The commander-in-chief's job is to train the army in the National Socialist idea, and I know of no general who could do that as I have done. For that reason, I have decided to take over command of the army myself." On December the 5th, 1941, the Russian army, reinforced by thousands of fresh troops brought in from Siberia, launched a massive and totally unexpected counterattack. Half frozen and starving, the German army abandoned vehicles and equipment and began fighting their way back toward German territory 500 miles to the west. By the end of December, German losses exceeded 800,000, more than a quarter of the original invasion force. At first, Hitler blamed Russian obstinacy for the disaster. The offensive spirit that inspires the Russian soldier does not surprise me. The explanation for it is their bottomless stupidity. Then Hitler blamed simple bad luck. Supplying the Russian front creates enormous problems. The catastrophe of the temperature falling from 2 degrees to 38 below in 2 days paralyzed everything. The situation was entirely unexpected. The truth was that Hitler and his high command had been so confident of a quick victory that they had ordered winter clothes for only 1/5 of the invasion force. The fault was entirely their own. Even before the onset of the Russian winter, the battle for Britain had turned against Germany. Retaliatory bombing raids on the German homeland increased, and aircraft losses were becoming incalculable. However, Germany's U-boat war against Britain was murderously successful. Hitler, as always, only ever saw the upside. I cannot conceive of anyone in England still believing in victory. The last thing these English know how to practice is fair play. They're very bad at accepting their own defeat. What does Churchill care for the lives of others? He is the most bloodthirsty, amateurish strategist in history. His abnormal state of mind can only be symptomatic of a paralytic disease or a drunkard's ravings. Opposition to Churchill is in the process of gaining strength in England. I never met anyone who didn't say he was off his head. He is an utterly amoral, repulsive creature. Britain was not surrendering. The Russians were not retreating. And perhaps most important of all, the United States was beginning to make its presence felt. The United States had initiated a massive aid program to Britain soon after the German Air Force began bombing British cities. But Hitler was convinced no amount of support could save the embattled British. All this talk about American reserves of men and material, it's just nonsense. I don't see much future for America. It's a decayed country. My feelings against the Americans are feelings of hatred and deep repugnance. Predictably, Hitler's hatred for Americans was directed toward their president, Franklin Roosevelt. I cannot be insulted by Roosevelt because I consider him mad. First, he incites war, then falsifies the causes, then odiously wraps himself in a cloak of Christian hypocrisy, and slowly but surely leads mankind to war. But the Americans could not be wished away. On December the 7th, 1941, Germany's allies, the Japanese, attacked the American naval base at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. Hitler was stunned by the unexpected turn of events. He would have preferred to keep the Americans out of the war for at least one and preferably 2 years, giving Germany time to rebuild its forces. Putting the best face on a bad situation, Hitler congratulated the Japanese ambassador. "This method is the only proper one. Always strike as hard as possible and not waste time declaring war." Supporting his Japanese allies, Hitler then declared war on the United States. By the end of 1942, thanks to a massive influx of American weapons, equipment, and manpower, England had virtually become one massive military base used as a staging point for unending air raids on Fortress Europe. The British bombed Germany by night and the Americans bombed by day. Furious, Hitler refused to believe his defenses would not hold. He lashed out at Roosevelt and Churchill. "The West can never win this war. The Allies are led by a drunk and a cripple." Realizing an Allied invasion of the continent was only a matter of time, Hitler tried to demoralize the Allies with propaganda. "I shall arrange an interview with foreign journalists on the subject of the British attempting to land on the coast of Europe. I will treat the subject in a manner that will come as a cold douche to the British. I will not say that I do not believe in the possibility of an invasion. On the contrary, I will emphasize that German military precision and thoroughness ensure that we are prepared for any and every eventuality." Privately, he began preparing for the inevitable invasion. "We must aim at securing a defensive line on Dutch soil because the war with England will be a life and death struggle. The idea that we can get off cheaply is dangerous. There is no such possibility. When the enemy invades in the West, it will be the moment of decision in this war, and that moment we must turn to our advantage. Obstacles do not exist to be surrendered to, but only to be broken." By spring 1944, German intelligence reported that the Allies were in a high state of readiness. As weeks turned to months, the bombing raids increased. Germany was being softened up for invasion. Obviously, an Anglo-American invasion in the West is going to come. The enemy's invasion must not, under any circumstances, be allowed to survive longer than hours, or at most, days. Once defeated, the enemy will never again try to invade. On June the 6th, 1944, the largest amphibious invasion force in history set sail for the French coast. 5,000 transport ships and 11,000 planes carried 176,000 men across the English Channel. The long-awaited Allied invasion of Europe had begun. Thank you. From their first tenuous foothold on the Normandy coastline, the Allies steadily drove the German army back through France. In the east, the Russians continued their massive assault. The Third Reich was being crushed in a vast, unyielding vice. On August the 24th, the city of Paris was liberated. Now desperate, Hitler clung to the belief that if he wanted something bad enough, he could make it happen by sheer willpower. The myth of our vulnerability in the event of a prolonged war must resolutely be disregarded. It is not permissible to believe that time is working against us. It is essential to deprive the enemy of his belief that victory is certain. I will continue this struggle, no matter against whom, until the safety of the Reich is secured. The day Paris was liberated, German-occupied Romania surrendered to Russian forces. 2 months later, Yugoslavia fell. Hitler's Nazi empire was being torn apart, piece by piece. As much as I may be tormented by worries, nothing will make the slightest change in my decision to fight on till the scales tip to our side. We shall smash the Americans completely. We shall yet master fate. As the tide of war turned inexorably against Germany, Hitler became isolated and withdrawn. Public appearances became rare. Like most Berliners, Hitler was forced to live beneath ground level. Moving from one dark underground bunker to another, Hitler grew morose, often overcome by fits of depression. No longer able to sleep, he wandered the dark halls, whistling and muttering to himself. I shall not live much longer. My health is growing worse all the time. We must hurry, we must hurry. It never occurred to Hitler that the disaster was entirely his own creation. It was always someone else's fault. If the world would only mind its own business, that was all I wanted, before the madman made me fight for the existence of Germany. I had plans and work for my people for 50 years to come. I didn't need to start a war to stay in office. Now, if something happens to me, Germany will be left without a leader. I have no successor. That something would happen to Hitler was always likely. Adolf Hitler was a hypochondriac, convinced that he was suffering from some life-threatening illness. His actual condition began to worsen back in 1935 when he met Dr. Theodor Morell, a quack who spent the next 10 years pandering to Hitler's imagined illnesses and injecting him with secret formulas. The effect can only be guessed at, but they undoubtedly contributed to Hitler's mental deterioration. Between Morell's treatments and the unending military disasters, Hitler became subject to violent fits of anger. He lashed out at anyone and everyone, stammering, drooling and spitting until he choked himself into exhaustion. I will outlast your President Roosevelt. I will also outlast this crazy man Churchill. I can afford to wait and win this war my way. No power on earth can shake the German Reich now. Divine providence has willed that I carry through the fulfillment of a Germanic task. When Hitler was in one of his moods, his guards whispered the warning to visitors, "For heaven's sake, don't irritate the Fuhrer." In July 1944, several members of his general staff tried to assassinate him with a suitcase bomb planted beneath the conference table. Although several officers were killed, Hitler escaped, but the effects never left him. His left arm now twitched uncontrollably, and he dragged one leg when he walked. Loud noises brought on violent shakes, and paranoia hung over him like a dark cloud. I feel like a prisoner here in these dugouts. My spirit can't escape. Often I go to the card room and pace to and fro, to and fro. By late 1944, 3 million German soldiers had been lost in 3 years of continuous warfare, mowed down by the Allies or lost to the merciless cold of Russia. Hitler's Third Reich had been bled dry. Now, 30,000 Russian tanks and planes were closing in from the east, and nearly 40 Allied divisions bearing down from the west. Adolf Hitler, barely in touch with reality, continued to issue orders to his divisions and armies that had ceased to exist. Groups of old men and fanatical boys were all that remained of Hitler's all-conquering Wehrmacht. Hitler, bunkered below the ruins of Berlin, jabbered incessantly to anyone who would listen. His mood shifted at random, and his thoughts wandered uncontrollably. I know that above all, the German army, every man and officer of it, supports me. The German people stand behind me to a man. They also provide me with the possibility of continuing the war, however long it may last. Hitler had imagined fantastic weapons that would allow him to turn the tide of war. Some had made it into battle, some did not. If I had a bomber capable of flying at more than 750 kilometers an hour, I'd have supremacy everywhere. What are the preferred targets? A bomb on a power station undoubtedly produces the desired effects. With 200 bombers fulfilling these conditions and continuing to fly for 6 months, I'll annihilate the enemy. Hitler also dreamed up bizarre plots in a dark fantasy world gone mad. It is possible that Moscow is using Churchill as a puppet. The British hate and despise the Bolsheviks, and one day the break will come. Believe me, Stalin is an arch blackmailer. The Americans will certainly invade Canada, and they may well have other demands which Britain will not tolerate. They are all doomed to defeat. On March the 25th, 1945, with his empire, his country, and his mind in ruins, Hitler demanded the destruction of Germany itself to deprive the enemy of the spoils of war. Everything which can be used by the enemy now, or in the foreseeable future, will be destroyed. Finally, Hitler had turned his wrath on his own people. It is not necessary to worry about what the German people will need for survival. Let them perish. April the 20th, 1945, was Adolf Hitler's 56th birthday. Huddled in his massive bunker beneath the ruins of the Chancellery, Hitler and his few remaining supporters gathered in a grim, pathetic celebration. Slumped in a chair, the Fuhrer sat in a dazed stupor, only rousing himself for the occasional outburst or to weep uncontrollably. I was Europe's last hope. She showed herself impervious to my charm and persuasion. To take her, I had to use violence. Now it is all over. The war is lost. I shall shoot myself. 5 days later, he did. Hitler's body was burned near that of loyal henchman Dr. Joseph Goebbels, who also killed himself after he and his wife poisoned their own children. Adolf Hitler claimed that he wished only to reverse the injustices of the First World War and restore Germany to her rightful place in the world. The Third Reich, built to last 1,000 years, had lasted barely 12, leaving Germany a shattered ruin. Worldwide, 40 million men, women, and children had been killed. 6 million helplessly exterminated in Nazi death camps. By weaving a skillful web of lies and deceit, Adolf Hitler had unleashed a hideous tyranny that came perilously close to destroying Western civilization. I shall feel I'm in my proper place if after my death I find myself together with people like me on some sort of Olympus. I shall be in the company of the most enlightened spirits of all times.